want to invite you guys to stand and sing with us this morning.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory.
Answer me quickly, O Lord. My spirit fails. Hide not your face from me, lest I be like those who go down to the pit. Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for I make me know the way I should go. For to you I lift up my soul. Deliver me from my enemies, O Lord. I have fled to you for refuge. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. For your name's sake, O Lord, preserve my life. One of the hardest things for me to learn and continue to learn is that the preservation of our life and God's good gifts for us and all those things that He wants to do for us is ultimately for His glory. You see, when God is glorified, the universe becomes right-sized. The health of the universe is predicated on God receiving glory. From my point of view, from a human point of view, that sounds very self-centered, narcissistic, selfish. Before a perfect God who created everything that exists, and everything that exists for Him, in Him, through His power, Colossians chapter 1 says the universe continues to function because of Christ. He is continuing to make everything continue. It is for His glory that we live. Even those who dismiss that are still living empowered by the gifts that He has given them. So today, let us choose to follow Him like we just read. Let's choose to lean in to bringing Him glory and allowing our lives to thrive for His sake as He preserves us. Would you guys sing with us this morning?
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will trust in you, my Lord, higher than my sight. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move.
Good morning. Welcome to Bellevue. I'm so excited to have you here at worship this morning and to have the opportunity to worship with you. If you're a guest with us, I hope you got one of these bulletins when you came in. If you did, there's a tear-off section on the bottom called a connections card. And if you would take just a couple of minutes and fill that out with your information, after the service is over, you can take that out either set of double doors in the rear of the sanctuary. And there's a blue tablecloth table in the hallway out there and a smiling person standing there. And they would love to give you a gift in return for that connections card, just so we can thank you for being with us this morning. Take a couple of minutes and shake some hands around you, and we'll continue to worship.
Lord, I Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe,
Lord, we
live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name.
You are.
Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe.
Lord, we
live for you. Yeah.
God, you are Father. You are Lord. You are King of Kings. You are sovereign. And even in the times, Lord, when we try to wrestle control away from you, you are still God. So, Lord, not only do we acknowledge that, but we also celebrate and worship the fact that not only are you sovereign and in control, but you are righteous and you are good and you are full of grace and mercy. Lord, there is no other God like you. And we praise your name through our voices, through the reading of your word, through the fellowship of one another, and also through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Lord, speak to us as we worship. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. And the church agreed and said,
Amen.
Amen. So when I started just a second ago, I was using this mic and I have this mic and I got really confused. So sorry about that. But this morning, you may have noticed we've got the CIA in the house, and that might have thrown some of you all off as you've seen the shirts walking around and what have you. But so what exactly is the CIA? You're handing out these sheets, and so maybe we should find out what the CIA is.
Okay. It's not a secret organization. It's an organization we want to make well known among our church family. We are here, it's called Christians in Action, and we are here to help you with any little thing that you have. So many times we have people in our church that need a helping hand, and it may be as something as simple as changing a light bulb, or they may need a handicap ramp. We go from one spectrum to the other, and we want people to sign up to be part of the CIA. That's what these green sheets are about. You put your name and contact information on there and fill out what you are capable of doing or what you're willing to do. There's also an area that says other, so if there's something that's not listed on there, please feel free to fill that out too. And we'll have people at the back taking these up at the end of the service. There'll be someone standing there with a shirt like this that will have a basket, and you can just drop your sheet in there. Or there's a drop box in the atrium where you can drop your sheets in there as well. And we will compile these things in a book, and we will make contact both with the individual that needs help and also the one who's going to do the help. And we also have another sheet. There. You take that. You tell them about the gold sheet.
Okay.
Okay, this is a gold sheet that you will receive next week. If you need help with something, you need someone to sit with the elderly, you need someone to change your light bulb, you've got a water leak, you've got a light switch that doesn't work, you've got a car that's not working properly. We're not going to come and overhaul your car, rebuild your house, but we're going to do minor repairs and help you also find people that can do the major stuff for you. So this will be handed out next week. If you need help, please take one of these next week, and they will also be available on a Connection Center.
So CIA is a ministry of Bellevue, and we need a lot of people to get involved, whether you're technically minded or not, and to minister to the needs within the body and help folks. So it could be somebody says, you know, I do okay. I don't have a lot of financial needs, but I just don't want to be taken advantage of, and I just would like to know what I should expect to do. We're going through that with my mom right now, the same thing. So you all can come out and check those things out and say you should kind of expect to pay this much, and that's what it is. You can help with that sort of thing too, right?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right.
Help anything, any way that they need help.
Any way you need help. So that's wide open. That's dangerous. Okay.
We're dangerous.
We just felt like we had a great missions group organization within the church that worked out of town and overseas, and it's very well known. And but we also felt like within our own church membership, we're a family, and we all have needs that, I mean, we can't possibly take care of all of our own needs. And that's what we're here for, to help each other out. And so if you think, you know, my mother comes to church with me and I can't climb a ladder and change her light bulbs, that's what we're here for. And, you know, you may think that it's not that important, but it is that important. And we just want to, you know, be a family and help each other. So Daryl and I felt like, you know, that was just something that God was calling us to do. We're a committee of eight, so we all are wearing our T-shirts today, and some of us are out of town. But anyway, we love you all and just want to, you know, even if it's just resources, you're a new member and you've moved into town and you don't know where is a good place to have your car fixed or where to get your oil change, you know, just call us up and we'll tell you.
Okay. And you can get in touch through the church office, but also you'll have the gold sheets next week that'll help with that. So fill this out. If you're interested in helping out with this team, hand it to them on the way out at the end of the service. Thank y'all. God bless you. Thanks.
It's always exciting to see a new ministry start, and I'm so appreciative to all those that are volunteering for the Christians in Action, and hope that you'll participate as God leads. I'm excited about this morning. I hope you're ready to study God's Word. If you would, take your Bibles out and turn to Joshua chapter 6. Joshua is your sixth book in the Bible. You got Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and then Joshua. And we've been out for about 2-3 weeks from our journey through Joshua, but today we start a whole new series, and we pick up on Joshua chapter 6. Today's series, or today starts the series called Road Toward Victory, and you'll get a sense of what that means throughout the message today. And my message today is titled The Challenge Before You. Some of you may be coming here today and saying, I have a challenge before me for sure, or I'm in the midst of a challenge, or I can see that what God's going to be calling me to, or what I'm going to have to address in my life in the coming days, I can tell that I'm going to be facing some challenges. Well, then this message is for you. I also encourage you to open up your Bellevue app and click on your sermon note function and access the outline there so you can follow along with me. You know, following Christ in your life, living for Him, is the most exhilarating life and calling that a man, woman, or child can experience. I mean, think about it for a moment. To live with God in your heart, the Word guiding your path, His purpose connecting you with your divinely designed significance, along with your sights set on an eternal home in heaven, that kind of life, the quality of that kind of life and perspective is unparalleled to anything else you could ever ask for or imagine in life. To live eternally, to live in connection with God, what a glorious thing. But any of us who have walked with God, who've sought to follow His will, to do His bidding, we know something. We know that the reality is that even when we obey God, when we follow His will, when we're pursuing His mission, we face formidable challenges in the midst of it. Big things can loom large in our path of following the Lord. We can run into high-walled obstacles that seem insurmountable, or we can experience what we definitely feel are attacks from which we fear we will not recover. But when we follow the Lord, these obstacles are often mere stopping places on God's road toward victory. Mere stopping places on God's road toward victory. It was the early church father and Syrian preacher of the 4th century, John Chrysostom, who once said this: "You are but a poor soldier of Christ if you think you can overcome without fighting and suppose you can have the crown without the conflict." My friends, the world, the flesh, and the devil are organized against Christ. And if your life is aligned with Christ and you are pursuing His path, then you can know that just as the nations in Canaan were organized against Joshua and the Hebrew people, so the world, the flesh, and the devil are organized against you. And the scriptures are clear. The believer's warfare today is not against flesh and blood, but against the dark and spiritual forces. We see this in Ephesians. And then we see in Matthew chapter 12, verse 30, that it is our responsibility to stand with Christ. And Jesus said, "Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters." And so along our road toward victory, we're going to face challenges. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We'll see that Joshua, on his road to victory, on his road to experiencing the victory of God for the people of God, he would face formidable, fortress-like obstacles that would challenge him. And so, if you would, look at Joshua chapter 6. And let's read this whole story here of Joshua chapter 6, the fall of Jericho. Now, this picks up right where we left off a couple weeks ago when we talked about preparing for a victory. And if you remember, Joshua had led the people of God across the Jordan River that God had miraculously parted, and God had brought them successfully into the Promised Land. It was a great victory. And they came up alongside this great fortified city of Jericho. That was the first city that needed to be conquered in order for the land to be taken. And Joshua looked out at the city, and you remember that as he was looking out at the city, he saw a vision of the angel of the Lord who indicated that he was the commander of the Lord's army. And he basically said, "The Lord will fight your battle, Joshua. The Lord has this. God assures victory." And so Joshua's had this experience, and now he's going to rally his people to do what the Lord will tell him to do, to take the city of Jericho. So we pick up here in verse 1 of chapter 6, it says, "Now Jericho," and if those of you that don't remember, Jericho is the first city that they would encounter. It's a fortified city, a large and fortified city. It has two large walls around it. To make it, hopefully, for the Jericho inhabitants, impenetrable by the enemy. It's a city that's on high ground, so it has the advantage. And the people of God were to take that city. And so it says, "Now Jericho was shut up inside and outside because of the people of Israel. None went out and none came in." They had bunkered down, you see. "And the Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have given Jericho into your hand, with its king and mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all the men of war, going around the city once. Thus shall you do for 6 days.'" So he says here, you're going to march around with all your men and everything else around the city. That would be pretty intimidating, wouldn't it, for the Jericho citizens. And he says, you're going to do that once, and then you're going to do that just like that for 6 days, and he says, "You shall march around the city, all the men of war, going around the city once. Thus you shall do for 6 days. 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. On the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times." So on the 7th day, he's to march around it 7 times. That'd be pretty significant. and the priests shall blow the trumpets. And when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, when you hear the sound of the trumpet, then all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up, every one straight before him. So the idea here is on the seventh day, they're going to march around the city seven times. They're going to blow the trumpet, the ram's horns, and they're going to blow this long trumpet blast. And then what's going to happen is everybody's to shout. They're instructed to shout this war cry. And then what happens? The walls just crumble down. God takes the walls right down on the city, knocks out the barrier, knocks out Jericho's advantage. And then all of Israel is to just rush right in, just walk right over the rubble, go in, take the city. Verse 6, so Joshua, the son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, take up the Ark of the Covenant and let seven priests bear seven trumpets of ram horns before the Ark of the Lord. And he said to the people, go forward, march around the city, and let the armed men pass on before the Ark of the Lord. And just as Joshua had commanded the people, the seven priests bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord went forward, blowing the trumpets with the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord following them. The armed men were walking before the priests who were blowing the trumpets, and the rear guard was walking after the ark while the trumpets blew continually. But Joshua commanded the people, you shall not shout or make your voice heard, neither shall any word go out of your mouth until the day I tell you to shout. Then you shall shout. So he caused the ark of the Lord to circle the city, going about it once, and they came into the camp and spent the night in the camp. Excuse me. Then Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord, and the seven priests bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord walked on, and they blew the trumpets continually. And the armed men were walking before them, and the rear guard was walking after the ark of the Lord, while the trumpets blew continually. And the second day they marched around the city once and returned into the camp. So they did for 6 days. On the seventh day, they rose early at the dawn of the day and marched around the city in the same manner seven times. It was only on that day that they marched around the city seven times. And at the seventh time, when the priests had blown the trumpets, here it comes, Joshua says to the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. And the city and all that is within it shall be devoted to the Lord for destruction. Only Rahab the prostitute and all who are with her in her house shall live, because she hid the messengers whom we sent. But you keep yourselves from the things devoted to destruction, lest when you have devoted them, you take any of the devoted things and make the camp of Israel a thing for destruction and bring trouble upon it. But all silver and gold and every vessel of bronze and iron are holy to the Lord. They shall go into the treasury of the Lord. Now this is unique. In future conquests of cities and villages and areas and regions, the people of God are going to be able to pillage. They're going to be able to take some of that property. But they're not to now. They're to devote it all to the Lord. It's the first fruit offering, essentially. It was their way of saying, it was God's way of showing them how they were to say, God got us into this, God's taking care of us, God's giving us the land, we honor God with the first fruits. Verse 20, so the people shouted, and the trumpets were blown. As soon as the people heard the sound of the trumpet, the people shouted a great shout, and the wall fell down flat. So it happened. So that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they captured the city. Then they devoted all in the city to destruction, both men and women, young and old, oxen, sheep, and donkeys, with the edge of the sword. But to the two men who had spied out the land, Joshua said, go into the prostitute's house and bring out from there the woman and all who belonged to her, as you swore to her. So the young men who had been spies went in, brought out Rahab and her father and mother and brothers and all who belonged to her, and they brought all her relatives and put them outside the camp of Israel, and they burned the city with fire and everything in it. Only the silver and gold, the vessels of bronze and of iron, they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. But Rahab the prostitute and her father's household and all who belonged to her, Joshua saved alive. And she has lived in Israel to this day, because she hid the messengers whom Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. Joshua laid an oath on them at that time, saying, cursed before the Lord be the man who rises up and rebuilds this city Jericho. At the cost of his firstborn shall he lay its foundation. At the cost of his youngest son shall he set up its gates. So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame was in all the land. So we see this amazing historical moment where the people of God take the first city of the promised land. Now, there's something we learn here about walking towards God and walking according to his will and doing his bidding. We will, as we do that, face challenges along the way. We fortified cities that need to be taken, difficulties and challenges that will loom large and might even frighten us. But what do you do when you face such challenges on your way of following God? Well, when you're following the Lord and face challenges, number one, the first thing in your outline is this: don't forget that you're fighting from a position of victory, not merely for a victory. Hello, this is important. Get the nuance of this. All right, don't forget that you're fighting from a position of victory, not merely for a victory. When you're following the Lord and then you face a challenge that rattles you, you got to remember that you're fighting from a position of victory. God has already assured the victory. And this is exactly what he does in Joshua chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. We see in verse 2, the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand with its king and mighty men of valor. Now, had the city been conquered yet? No. In verse 2, he says, see, look at the city, I've given it to you. Well, they're all still in the city. The walls are still up, right? They're still ruling their own people. They're alive. But God says, it's as good as you already having it, because I just declared this city is going to be taken by you. It's my will that these people have full judgment on it. I've been declaring judgment on these people for centuries, and the fullness of time has come for judgment. But also, this is the one thing that is a barrier to you taking the rest of the land, and I've already given you the land, and so you just need to know, victory is assured. You got a challenge before you, right, on the road to victory, but the victory, you're on the road of victory. So you're on the road toward victory. The victory, you're already on a position of victory. This is going to get you there. And God even says in verses 3 through 5 how he's going to do it. And explains the walking around and all this and the walls coming down. And you know, God does the same thing for us. We need to realize that God shows us how the victory is won. By his promises in his word. By what he's done already in the past. By being able to see those patterns and recognize that if we'll follow the Lord in the same way, God will be with us as well. He also shows us that we're fighting from a position of victory. Not everything in life is assured, but that God's will come to pass in his time, in his way, is assured. But nonetheless, we can get rattled when we come to an obstacle in the path of following God. The challenge can loom large and can shake our faith. Some of you may be experiencing this right now. You know, in the land of Canaan, there were a collection of several city-states, each one led by a king. They have a city, the people live around the city and within the city, and there's a king. And so over that small region, there's what we call a city-state. By today's standards, we would consider them small. By those standards back then, they were pretty large. And we can see, archaeologists have shown us that the scriptures itself says that the city of Ai, which we're going to talk about in future messages, was smaller than Jericho and was about 12,000 people. And archaeology tells us that Jericho, the city that we're talking about right here, probably covered about 8 acres and was protected by 2 high parallel walls, which stood about 15 feet apart from each other and were much higher than 15 feet, of course, and surrounded the city. And that doesn't sound like a whole lot to you and me, but let's remember that decades before, the Hebrew people had come in, explored the land, right, saw these cities, and were scared to death, went back, gave a bad report to their people, so much so that the people rebelled and wouldn't go into the promised land as God had led them. They faltered in their faith, looking at these walled cities. You know, sometimes we can be going along in our pathway of seeking to follow the Lord, and we come up with a barrier, a challenge, and we get scared. We get frightened. Challenges often scare us on the path of following Christ on our road towards victory. And those challenges that try to scare us from moving forward in our devoted direction for the Lord shouldn't stop us, because our ultimate victory is assured. Let me ask you a question. Are you striving in your life right now to live devoted to Christ, to resist the devil, live according to his ways, but you are facing a derailing temptation? Or are you seeking to pursue a dream God placed on your heart, but there's a financial obstacle before you and you don't know how to take it down? Or are you engaged in a ministry and you're not sure how to overcome a challenge to get that ministry to grow? Or maybe it's something else, but just remember that you are not merely fighting for a victory. Like, oh, I got to get this. I got to win this. I got to somehow find a way. You're fighting from a position of victory. Because if God called you to it, if God commanded it of you, God will bring the victory in his time and his way. And it may not happen just like you think or when you think, but if it is of God, it will come to pass in his time and his way. How do you need to think differently about your challenge in light of this? You know, the Christian believer stands in a position of ultimate guaranteed victory. Think about it. Jesus has already defeated all spiritual enemies. John chapter 12, verse 31 says this, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out." And he defeated the enemy when tempted. We see this in his temptation in Matthew chapter 4. He was tempted, but he resisted successfully. He also gained victory on the cross when he died for our sins and broke the curse of the devil. And in his resurrection and his ascension, he declared his glory and his grace and his victory. And as Paul said, if God is for us, who can be against us? So we see here in verses 3 through 5 of chapter 6 of Joshua, we see that God tells the people to march around the city over 7 days, and in the last day, 7 times. And what is 7? In the Hebrew language and in the Hebrew culture, 7 indicates completeness, fullness, wholeness. And what's being indicated here is that God could finish everything that he started. Sometimes we wonder how long it's going to take. They must have thought that as they're, are we going to do this again? And oh, today we're doing it again and again and again and again, all the way to 7? Sometimes we think it's going to take forever. But God's got his plan, and he will fulfill what he started. The Bible teaches us that he who began a good work in you will complete it. The Hebrews had 2 different kinds of trumpets, and we see one of them blown here. They're told to blow the ram's trumpets. Now, there were silver trumpets that they had, and sometimes they would use those silver trumpets to indicate something important was about to happen. But a ram's trumpet, a ram's horn, more often than not, called the shofar, was more often than not a celebrative noise. It was used to celebrate what God had done. They were to go around and essentially say, God has given us this city. God is the one that gives the victory. God has done it, and it's as good as done, and so we're going to celebrate even before it happens. We need to recognize that while we face challenges, we need to be celebrating. God, we know you're going to get us through this because you called us to it. And you allowed this challenge to be faced by us, which means that you have a way, a road towards victory through this thing. When you're following the Lord and face challenges, 2nd on your outline, when you're in the midst of the challenge, that's the hardest part, isn't it? When you're in the midst of the challenge, don't stop believing. Hear me, because I'm going to help you right now. Some of you, you need to hear this right now. You need to hear, don't stop believing. I think of the patience the people had to have here in Joshua chapter 6. They could have just stormed the city, right? But instead, they trusted God in His timing and His instructions. God had given very specific instructions what to do. And they were to trust Him in it and keep doing it. And with every step, they were trusting that those instructions and that promise from God was going to lead to the victory. They had to have faith. We see this in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 30, when the Bible speaks of this time. It says, by faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they had been encircled for 7 days. Every time the priests, every time the soldiers had to take another step, they were saying, we believe that God's going to do this. We believe that God's going to do it. We're not foolish. We may feel foolish sometimes in the midst of the challenge, but we believe that God's going to do this. You might be continuing to follow the Lord and seeking the Lord, but the challenge is still there, and it hasn't gotten resolved, and you're keeping on, right? Keeping on trucking, as they used to say in the late 60s, early 70s when I was a little kid. You know, they just kept on going, right? And why'd they do that? Because they had faith. They chose to keep believing. Boy, it's taken a long time. Boy, we're going to march again. Boy, really? You know? Well, that's fine because God said it. God's going to do it. We're going to keep our focus on God. Now listen, when you're in the midst of the challenge, keep believing. And that doesn't mean that you believe despite the evidence. Hear me. It means you take into consideration the evidence of God's promises and past faithfulness. The Israelites were not choosing to believe on the basis of a blind leap of faith. Not at all. They had seen the Lord's track record of faithfulness. And when God called them to the things in the past, in His timing and in His ways, He came through for them at the right time in the right way. And all of these things proved God's word and God's power could be trusted. Think about it for a moment. God had opened the Red Sea. God had destroyed the Egyptian army. God had cared for His people in the wilderness. God had defeated kings, even gave Israel their land, opened the Jordan River. The list goes on and on and on, and those things had been done, not just all at once, but done over the course of time. They could see that. They could say, on the basis of God's promises and the basis of the evidence of Him, of how He's come through for us in the past, we can have faith He'll come through for us in the future. We're on the road to victory. We may be facing the challenge, but we just keep on believing and keep on taking steps forward. Now you look at our own church history here, Bellevue, just in the last many years. You know, God called us almost 2 decades ago to relocate so that we could reach more people for Christ, have more possibilities for generations to come, to relocate to this new piece of property here and to build this new campus. And those of you that were here a long time ago with me, you know that many obstacles delayed our move here to this land and this campus, circumstantial and financial. And the obstacles delayed things for years beyond what we either hoped or planned. And I'm telling you, we could have easily started to doubt that it would happen or that God would come through. And if that were the case, we would have yielded to such a temptation and it could have made us quit the endeavor altogether. And I'll be honest, there were times when my faith was a little bit fatigued. But our leaders and our people chose to keep believing. And they knew that God had called them to do this thing for reaching our city and world and chose to keep believing in the midst of the challenges. And we wouldn't be worshiping here today if that wasn't the case. We kept believing and believing, believing, even when the resources weren't coming, even when the circumstances were not aligning for us to be able to. The walls hadn't come down yet. But oh my goodness, in the summer of 2006, the walls came down and everything moved fast after that. But we had to just keep on believing. And you need to do that in your own life. Some of you have been following the Lord. You're in the midst of the challenge. And there's part of you that's tempted to step off the road of following the Lord and quit. Just stop. Or maybe God's not going to come through. Stop believing. No. Keep taking steps forward. If God called you to it, then take steps forward toward it. Trust the Lord. And the third thing is when you're following the Lord and you face challenges. Number three, when the victory is won, do these two things. Listen, What you do after the victory is won is just as important as what you do before it. Because God allowed the challenge to come to prepare you for what was next. It's often after the victory that your opportunity for great good or great failure is presented. Andrew Bonar said this, "Let us be as watchful after the victory as before the battle." You see, my friend, we're going to see, and we're going to see this next week, how one soldier did not do the following things, and because of that, great defeat came upon the people. Now, we'll talk about that next week. But here are the two things that you need to do after the victory's won, after the thing that you're struggling with right now gets settled. Number one, obey God's commands. Obey God's commands. And number two, give God the glory. Give God the glory. Let me explain. We see here that the people followed the commands. They said, march around once every day, 6 days, seventh day, march around seven times. Shout, right? Run in. But that wasn't the only thing that they were to do. What else were they to do? They were also to go and engage in the defeat of the city. And they were to devote the entire city to the Lord. You think about what they were called to do. They were devoted to basically say this whole city and everything in it is God's. And we're taking it. They were to rescue Rahab and her family as an act of grace and mercy and a sign of the gospel. And they were to destroy the people and burn the city as an act of God's judgment and a clearing away so that they could obey without the influence of that paganism in their life to come. And they followed those instructions. Now, we're going to see that one man didn't, and we're going to see what the results of that are later. And we don't see that in this chapter yet. But here's the thing, and this is so important. They obeyed the command, and they did it for His glory. They were basically saying, this whole city is for You, Lord. We glorify You. You're the one that took this city. We came in and we're instruments of You, but You took the city. My friends, whenever God gives you a victory and does a victory in your life, you need to keep on obeying Him. Keep on following Him. Keep on doing His will. Because He led you through the challenge to prepare you to do even more for Him and in His service. And you do it for His glory. A, you don't take credit for the victory. Yeah. Boy, yeah, I took that city. Way to go. No. You don't take the glory. You give Him the glory. There's really nothing that we can do apart from Him enabling us to do it. And it's really, really important that we move forward and follow the Lord, knowing that we are doing so from the position of victory. Not merely for a victory. And that while we're in the midst of it and it's hard and we're struggling maybe even to believe, that we keep on believing and saying, God wants me to keep on going. And then when it gets better, we say, all right, Lord taught us something here. Now let's keep on obeying and keep on glorifying Him. And some of you are going through a challenge right now and you needed this message, and this message helps you. Because God's saying to you, don't quit. Some of you, for you, it's even so intense that, and other people around you don't know it, but you go, I've wanted to follow the Lord and serve the Lord, but you know, the challenges are so hard, and I'm not sure God's going to come through for me. And you know, maybe it would be better just if this life were over for me. If I just got off the road altogether. Don't do it. Jesus is calling you to Himself and to His ways and to His truth and to His life and to His love. Don't get off the road. You're on the road to victory. You're just facing a challenge. It's according to His purpose and plan. So follow Him. Keep following Him. Keep obeying Him. And He will lead you there. Would you bow with me in prayer? Almighty God, Father, we thank you that we are not alone, but that you call us to victory upon victory. Sometimes it doesn't seem like it, though, because we're standing before a fortified city, an obstacle of high walls, something difficult that makes our knees shake and our palms sweat. And when we're in the midst of it, dear Father God, our heart pounds so fast and we wonder, is God there? Is he going to get us through? When will this be over? And yet, Father, you call us to have faith and to keep on going, knowing that the victory's already won. The city's already been given. And God is to be glorified. Father God, we come before you right now and we pray that anybody that's here that's dealing with a challenge on their journey of following you would feel a sense of peace knowing that you're going to get them through. And Lord God, may it give them greater patience to keep on believing, to be devoted and obedient, and to live for you fully. And Father God, for those who have yet to receive Jesus, who feel on the outside of faith, would you call them today to faith, to realize that you are inviting them into a relationship with Jesus, a relationship of forgiveness, a relationship that lasts forever. And may you invite them into that relationship in such a profound way that, dear Father God, that they would give themselves fully to you and begin a walk with Christ. Lord God, lead us all to deeper commitment and lead us to blow the trumpet of celebration, celebrating that even when we're in our challenge, you have victory, ultimate victory for all of your people. And today, may we leave here with that truth pulsating in our souls. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.